The topic of the Romanian saints of the communist prisons is a narrative of traumatic memory that surfaced after 1990 within several specific contexts. It is a narrative that has been used by some as a means of political and moral legitimation, but at the same time it is a narrative that has given healing to others, creating a generational bond and expanded public interest in the traumatic experiences of political detention during communism. The saints and the sainthood, the martyrdom of the communist prisons, are tied to the issue of repression, and specifically to how the history and memory of the repression were constructed, how the victims, the survivors, those who were tortured, and those who lived to tell, actually told their stories. The manner in which they recounted was also important. They either did it heroically, highlighting moral values, or compassionately, like a confession or like a testimony. But also the content of the survivors' stories stood out. Such were the bright examples of several political prisoners who deepened their Christian faith, who understood and accepted unjust detention and torture as redemption for their sins, or in some cases as martyrdom. As a narrative of traumatic memory, the issue of the saints of the prisons is connected to the memorialization of suffering, to communities, practices, and public discourse. In the Romanian landscape of memory and remembrance from the early 1990s, a plethora of testimonies appeared, and the duty to confess took many forms. In those years, to recover the memory of the Gulag had first of all an informative purpose, to get in touch with a history that had been hidden during the communist years. Therefore, in the context of a restricted access to the archives, memory was the sole manner of researching the events from the communist prisons. This effort of remembering held strong ethical and social implications and overlapped with the political turmoil of the 1990s. Recovering the lost memory happened in the background of the symbolic confrontation between the inheritors of the communist regime that were camouflaging into a new power versus civil society, dissidents, survivors of the Romanian Gulag, and their families. In these particular circumstances, recovering the memories of the communist years held political implications as well, as memory was being conjured to support the anti-communist discourse as well as to legitimate the different political parties, successor of the traditional parties that had previously opposed the communist regime. So members of the Peasant Party, the Liberals Party, and even the inheritors of the legionary movement cultivated the memory of the victims of communism as a form of political action. The Sighet Memorial, founded in 1993, undertook the difficult task of recovering memory and promoting it as a form of moral justice. It was not until the following decade that the narrative of sainthood and martyrdom of the communist prisons gained more ground. When speaking of the saints of the communist prisons, a timeline of the narrative's evolution firstly reveals year 1992, when, in what probably was the most read book of the era, Nicolae Steinhardt's Diary of Happiness, Le Journal de la Félicité, Steinhardt named Valeriu Gafencu, a former legionary arrested in his youth, among the saints of the prisons. So this is the first time the syntagma appeared in connection to Gafencu's name. That same year, several former political prisoners started to gather testimonies regarding Gafencu in order to forward them to a sanctification commission of the Romanian Orthodox Church. The action was ended due to the sudden death of the initiator, and most of the testimonies would go on to be published only a decade later in the first ever book dedicated to student Valeriu Gafencu, the Saint of the Romanian Prisons, in 2003, edited by Nicolae Trifoiu. Also during 1992-1993, hero monk Justin Pârvu, himself a former political prisoner, built in his hometown village from Neamț County a small monastery explicitly dedicated to those who suffered in the communist prisons. In regards to the remembrance of heroes and martyrs, a monastery is different from a memorial or a monument due to its constant liturgical nature, in which memory and anamnesis are embedded. Each daily liturgy or service includes reference to the martyrs and victims of repression, which makes this an active memorial practice as well as a vehicle for the discourse on the saints and martyrs of the communist prisons. Memorial efforts were also expressed by the Association of Former Political Prisoners from Romania. Throughout the 1990s, their national and local associations built memorial monuments in cities and towns across the country that connected to former places of detention, forced labor camps, or executions. One such initiative, which is important to our topic, was the monument from Aiud, a small town known for its large century its large 18th century prison, which is one of the most common places, the most famous common place in the memory of the Romanian Gulag. The memorial monument from Aiud was built between 1992 and 1999 through the consistent efforts of several political prisoners. Even the architects who designed the monument and oversaw its construction had served political detention in the Aiud prison. In 2004, the monument also received liturgical significance. It became a church, as aforementioned Hieroman Cristin Pârvu received the archbishop's permission and blessing to erect a new monastery explicitly dedicated to the memory of those who died in prison at Aiud and in the entire Romanian Gulag. These two monasteries, along with another one founded under the spiritual direction of the same Cristin Pârvu, the Diaconești Monastery, were the forefront in the development of the discourse surrounding the saints of the communist prisons. The monastic communities wrote prayers, hymns, and composed carols using lyrics written in detention by former political prisoners. As for the circulation of testimonies and publishings, despite the 1990s decade being an effervescent scene for a wide number of publications, the detention literature back then mainly focused on individual experiences of trauma during detention, without necessarily conceptualizing or pushing for the ideas of sainthood and martyrdom. However, as the tales kept surfacing and the former political prisoners wrote memoirs and gave oral history interviews to those interested in their stories, several heroic, virtuous, and self-giving characters emerged as a common point. Gradually, some of them came to be known as the saints of the prisons, which became an umbrella concept to define 20th century martyrdom in the communist prisons. These were the people who had openly asserted their Christian faith and who sacrificed their health or their lives to save others, such as Mircea Lucănescu or Valeriu Gafencu, or who had rediscovered the depths of their Christian identity in prison and practiced it fervently despite the hate and the abuses of the prison administration. In 2003, the first volume that covered testimonies about Valeriu Gafencu, the saint of the prisons, appeared. The volume sold out and was not re-edited. Further on, years 2006 and 2007 marked the publishing of the two most important books shaping the discourse about the saints of the communist prisons, namely Ioan Ianolide's Return to Christ and, respectively, the Saint of the Prisons, a collection of testimonies put together by monk Moise Iorgovan, who referenced heavily the previous 2003 volume on Valeriu Gafencu, but also enriched it with valuable testimonies personally collected by the editor. 2007 also marks an important volume with far less impact, but with greater institutional significance. Contemporary Martyrology, a collaborative project prompted by St. Gerhard's Werk Foundation, with the active concours of the Romanian Orthodox Church, the Roman Catholic Dioceses, the Greek Catholic Dioceses, and the Confession Augustana Evangelical Church, who gathered hundreds of biographies, expressions of suffering for one's religious beliefs during the communist regime. From this point forward, the story of the saints of the communist prisons spread amazingly fast, becoming popular and at the same time raising controversies due to the pre-detention political identity of those considered the saints of the prisons, namely their affiliation to the youth organizations of the legionary movement. This made for really heated debates, because the public who sympathized with the narrative of the communist prison saints pushed for sanctification. The association that continued the inheritance of the legionary movement sought to legitimate themselves symbolically by using this narrative and expanding it to the entire legionary movement. The Elie Wiesel Institute flaunted the anti-Semitism of the prisoners' political affiliations. Finally, the Holy Synod of the Romanian Orthodox Church was not fond of the subject due to all the issues above, as well as to their own controversial heritage of institutional collaborationism with the regime, despite a great number of priests having experienced political detention. So all these antagonistic discourses surrounding the narrative of the saints of the prisons strongly clashed between 2008 and 2013. A 2008 TV documentary aired on the national television was suggestively entitled "Why Aren't We Sanctifying the Anti-Communist Martyrs?" It accused the Holy Synod of the Romanian Orthodox Church of indifference, and among others it reported the censorship of an itinerant exhibition that promoted biographies associated with martyrdom, some of which were considered threats due to the legionary political affiliation of the prisoners. It would take another couple of years for researchers to properly define the mingling and the shifts in the prisoner political identities and conceptions during their political detention. The official response of the Orthodox Church towards the public piety only came in 2013 when the official spokesman of the Romanian Orthodox Church stated that the sanctification of the martyrs of the communist prisons would be discussed only after the church dealt chronologically with the saints of the 17th, 18th, and 19th centuries. So it would take another 4 more years until the church decided to embrace the subject. Reverential year 2017 was dedicated to the defenders of the faith during the communist regime. So despite this euphemistic definition, the initiative led to a rise in archive research and the further popularization of the narrative of martyrdom in the communist prisons. This chronological outline shows the extensive spread of the narrative in the mid and late 2000s, and most importantly, it raises the question, why did the narrative of the saints of the prisons have impact only then and not in the early 1990s, and how were these developments shaped by the historical and political context, or in return, how did they affect it? Two very important institutions that managed the history and memory of the communist repression were established in the same decade, in parallel with the development of our narrative. The National Council for the Study of the Securitate Archives, the CNSAS, put under the authority of the Parliament in 2000, and the Institute for the Investigation of Communist Crimes and Memory of the Romanian Exile, put under government authority in 2005. CNSAS meant the opening of the archives of repression, despite it being used often as a political tool that granted certificates of collaborationism with the political police, while the Institute for the Investigation of Communist Crimes and Memory of the Romanian Exile undertook archaeological investigations for the remnants of executed victims, as well as a belated form of transitional justice, and succeeded in attaining prison sentences for two former torturers and prison guards. The activity of these institutions is non-negligible, and in fact, their existence propelled the study of the communist period. More documentation and available archives were also gained for the narrative of sainthood and of communist prisons, as the proofs of repression brought forward not only the abuses of the regime, but also the biographies, strategies, and responses of the repressed. So if we were to evaluate what consequences the narrative regarding the saints of the communist prisons had, a couple would stand out. First of all, the popularization of the subject of communist crimes and the universe of detention from the communist prisons. Secondly, the public's attraction towards saints and sainthood made it easier to relate to some of the victims of the communist prisons. Considering them as martyrs or saints brought both controversy and relief. Furthermore, a very strong popular piety was born once the stories and the testimonies spread and were published in numerous copies. The aforementioned volume, Saints of the Prisons, was printed in 3,000 copies, had a second and third Romanian edition, and even an English edition. Thirdly, the public's identification through the accounts and experiences of individual suffering and familial dramas and disrupted biographies often offered hope and encouragement from these traumatic testimonies of the ancestors, which somehow suggests that the narrative might have translated into a more universal experience of suffering. Last but not least, this narrative has connected a younger generation to the memory of the older one. Students taking oral history interviews from former political prisoners, reading detention literature, and overall raising the youth's awareness of the subject of communist repression. So, what does it mean to be a saint or a martyr of the communist prisons? The 2007 Collective Martyrology mentioned several conditions for a martyr or confessor. Death through violence, martyrium materialiter, the hate of the repressors towards the Christian faith, martyrium formaliter ex parte tyranni, and the conscious acceptance of God's will, martyrium formaliter ex parte victime. Despite still searching, reinterpreting, and discerning definitions of sainthood and martyrdom, the impact of the narrative of the saints of the communist prisons has been undeniable and has somehow turned into what Romanian researcher of the concentrationary universe, Ruxandra Ceseranu, called a healing memory. A memory that has achieved beyond justice and remembrance, a healing of the traumatic past. I hope my presentation has sparked your interest in the issue, and thank you so much for your patience.